it's the barrier and the sense of guilt is, especially if it's somebody who's targeted, you know, your own community. You, your children, are all made them into targets. I mean, that's a tremendous barrier. I can't say that in the case of the president, that that's the issue. I think that's from a place of great imperial power, and also this desperate need to simplify the world into good versus evil. That is, I don't think that's, I don't know where that's coming from. I know that at least in my case and other people's cases, it takes a tremendous amount of discipline to sit there and do this. And I found it to be one of the most, in some ways, exalted experiences of my life. Because in the end, it taught me that I can have, see, let me interrupt myself. A very simplistic and fundamentalist moral reasoning is that if I treat somebody else as a human being, I've accepted their ethics, or I've accepted their values. And so how can I talk to a terrorist and treat them as a human being? It means that I've succumbed to terrorism, or succumbed to the logic of terrorism. And one of the wonderful things about that happens to you, or that should happen to you if you work with people in prison, when you work with, you know, convicted criminals, or you work with people who are serious killers, is that you can treat them with great respect and honor, and come out with your values intact, and know that you've done that. That you can say, I'm going to honor this person. I would be thrilled someday if they were in prison, but I actually have an affection for them, but they need to go to jail someday. Or I'd like to get circumstances in such a way that 20 years from now they'll be in jail. So you have that duality when you're talking to somebody, which is very difficult to maintain. But, you know, good diplomats do this in their sleep. You know, there's a lot of good diplomats in the world who do this, and this is why there's a breakdown in diplomacy, of the inability to make that kind of, you know, parsing out and distinction. I also think it's just enormously hypocritical, because there are so many heads of state that are treated like gold because they're good allies, and they have enormous amounts of blood on their hands through their armies and such. So, you know, for me personally, to have sat with a terrorist was an emotionally wrenching experience, transformative, and so on. Because I don't usually sit with those kind of, so I don't even understand the mentality that's comfortable with a head of state who's done this, and not comfortable with somebody who's done this in a different way. And the more I've gotten to know about, I mean, I think the logic of why it's different is that there's a lot of pretense in elite circles in the world. If there's a certain head of state and they're very presentable and they're nice and they're charming, and by the way, they have torture prisons that we can use at a certain point, you don't really talk about that and you don't have to think about it. It's all very beautiful and wonderful. But when you're going to deal with a guerrilla group or a terrorist group, you're having to face this dichotomy, and a lot of people don't do well with those dichotomies. I don't know. It's a bit of a mystery to me, but that's some of my speculation. Yeah.
What about the people you said that give lip service to the idea of including cultural aspects? You said that they just give lip service. Do you think that it's that they don't actually go forward on it because of fear, because of lack of knowledge, or what do you think motivates that?
In my experience, it's two things. One is that their jobs give them permission to do the kind of diplomacy and negotiation that's acceptable and normal. And going out of those parameters will risk their jobs. This is particularly true of bureaucracies. What's interesting is when you get out in the field, like a senior, I've worked with people who are in embassies, and they really get this, so they secretly try to help. It's secret. It's unofficial. I've also met ambassadors who get this and do it openly because they're ambassadors and they seem to be in a strong position to have discretion to do these, to engage in rituals and culture and conflict resolution. I don't know why some countries seem to be better at it than others. I've had very positive experience with Switzerland and with Canada and Morocco. And you know, and it may be the personalities of the ambassadors that I worked with, but it may also be the discretion they have within that system. So, I think the higher up you go, the more that a personality and people's natural gifts play, the more that they're constrained by a system. It's their jobs that are at stake because it's not an acceptable part of the system and there's no way to quantify it. I think a systematic change would be a mandate from the top to encourage experimentation and to allow people to experiment and fail and gave them guidelines as to how big the failure can be or not be. In other words, if you're going to make experimentation part of diplomacy, you'd have to sort of give people guidelines about how to do it without it being catastrophe. So, okay, do something small and see how it goes. Don't do big things. You know, just see. Let's see if this works in our form of diplomacy. I don't hear those discussions yet at all in the American case. I think American diplomacy in general is seems to have less experience or be less sophisticated than European diplomacy. I mean, when you think about it, for all the weaknesses of European culture in terms of fascism and communism and other, you know, totalitarianisms, there's a long history of experience with empire and with dealing with other people's cultures. People say this in general, this is a whole debate among the neoconservatives and others and the imperialists, is that, you know, the British were far better at this. The British Foreign Office was legendary at knowing how to work with other people's cultures because they were so used to ruling. Whereas there's a great deal of ambivalence to the United States form of imperialism because it's sort of suddenly finding yourself with 150 bases around the world and the superior force, but not really any experience or even comfort with the idea of being an empire. There's no notion of being an empire. We pretend there isn't an empire. And yet we're the most powerful nation on earth and we have these hundreds of bases everywhere. So it's a very strange relationship with the other. And I found that among European diplomats, on balance, much more used to these cultural negotiations. It also may be that the European environment is so fractured among so many different cultures and languages that you can't even get by without knowing five languages. And that in itself, even learning five languages, from the time you were little, it itself creates a consciousness of multiculturalism and diplomacy that you wouldn't have if you've only had one language and you'd never been out of the country. Do you know that half the people in Congress don't even have a passport? They don't have a passport. I was trying all this time to get people to come to this country and that country and the World Economic Forum, and I realize that a lot of people are elected to Congress. They're from very small districts. They don't really have a desire to go out of the country. They're very satisfied with their American experience, very proud Americans. It's a huge country. And they're frankly frightened, especially once they become targets for the terrorists to go. And I've underestimated my own breaking of barriers. You know, once you do these things and you become international, you forget how many people are afraid of doing that. And if anything, the whole system of diplomacy training in the United States creates great fears because you're surrounded by all of these rules and regulations of what you can do and can't do. And it sort of just encourages you to be terrified, which is you know, it's a challenge. It is an age of terrorism. It is a, the United States is the number one target. It isn't easy. But this problem with culture and conflict resolution was there before the age of terror, before 9/11, before, you know, it's been going on for a while. And, so all of those are factors. I want to move on to Christianity in the second part. So I think we should take a break now, and we'll move on to Christianity, because I want to try and stick with the schedule.